Hello, everybody, and welcome to another session of Musical Mornings. My name is Rachel. I am a voice, guitar, and piano instructor here at Rock Island Sound. And if you've tuned into my streams from the past couple weeks, then you'd know that we've been talking about the history of popular music in the United States. And on Tuesday, we were focused on popular artists and influential artists of the 2000s, so from 2000 to 2010. And we had a really great conversation and stream talking about that. And today, we are finally caught up to the present. So we are going to be talking about the popular and influential artists from 2010 to now. So all of these artists that we're going to talk about have been deeply influenced by all the other popular artists that we've discussed in the past. And it's always important to make those connections and see who's influenced by who. How would this person have succeeded if there was not this person first? And that's always something important to think about. For today, I want to talk about three women. I decided I wanted to go with all women. Girl power, who have been extremely influential in the pop music scene and in, you know, dipping into other genres as well, not just pop, but three extremely influential women singers and songwriters. They do all of it, and much more, who have definitely defined the 2010s. So we're going to start off talking about one of my absolute favorites, and that would be Taylor Swift. I'm sure that you guys know who Taylor Swift is. And the really cool thing about Taylor Swift is that she started out more in the country music scene and then was able to shift her career and her fan base towards more of a pop music sound and a pop scene. And that's really awesome because a lot of artists aren't ever able to make that switch and have it work successfully. Sometimes you feel boxed in to a certain genre and you have no way of going about moving out of that. Other times you know that you want to move out of that, but when you do try a new sound, it's not received well. Maybe you're not as strong at it, different things like that. But with Taylor Swift, she was able to make a very strong switch over to the pop side. She's really well known for her songwriting specifically, and that is a very narrative songwriting, which really just means that she's very good at telling stories and painting pictures and giving a clear description of what's happening without just telling you. She shows you through her descriptors, through her metaphors, through the way that she writes these songs. And that is what she's most well known for, is how talented of a songwriter she is. But as the years have gone on, her vocals and her performance skills have gotten a lot better as well. And it's really lovely to see somebody who got famous at the age of 14, then by like 25, 26, really have grown into herself and become the performer that she always was, but without letting all of that, those reservations from the past, hold her back. So she grew up in Pennsylvania, but they quickly relocated to Nashville when she was around 9 years old. And like I said, she was signed to Sony Publishing House at age 14. And she released her first album in 2006. And although that she did amazingly then, and the album was the longest charting album of the 2000s on the Billboard 200, which is crazy. And a lot of it, they'd never seen a young person single-handedly write and perform a song herself, let alone a number one song. So she did set a lot of records even before 2010. And her 2008 album won 4 Grammys as well. But once we get to 2010, she starts dipping out of the country scene. And that's where she really starts to grow into herself, like I said. She really changed every style and every genre and flipped it on its head with each album that came after 2010. She kept trying new things, not letting anyone who told her not to be experimental hold her back, and she continued to win Grammys for every project that she's released, other than her 2017 album, which some people, although it was the first and only act in music history to sell a million copies in the first week, after four other albums that did that too in the past years, she didn't win any Grammys for that Reputation album because at that time, there was still a lot of media misrepresentation about her because of some other artists who tried to take her down. It's very hard being a woman in the music industry. It's very hard being a woman in any industry because there's always going to be men trying to steal your successes and ruin your career. But Taylor did not let that fully eclipse her, and she kept working. And her most recent album that came out in August, called Lover, is a work of art. She's one of the world's best-selling music artists of all time. She has 10 Grammy Awards, an Emmy Award. She's the most awarded woman in the American Music Awards with 29 wins. And the Billboard Music Awards, too, with 23 wins. She really just has changed what we thought was somebody who was just a country singer, and she really took that and changed it and said, I can do more than one thing, and I can make and adapt to the new shifting music scene. And it's really interesting to see. And now, you know, she's had a documentary that's come out, and she just has been doing a lot of great stuff, and I'm really looking forward to her next project. I think that everybody who grew up in my era knows who Taylor Swift is and knows that even if you love or hate her, she's incredibly influential and has been so successful, rightfully so. So her album, 1989, was the first real departure from her country roots. And let's just listen to a little bit of a song from that album called Blank Space. Yeah, I highly recommend listening to all of her work, but particularly her most recent album, I think, is so authentic to who she's been trying to be, who she really has been for so long, but was not able to be because of all of the media misrepresentation and media attacks, essentially, that went on her for just being a successful woman. And now, you know, she's really just a pop, synth pop rock artist. And she did describe herself as a country artist until around like 2013. But she made the change. And like I said, it worked for her. So another really popular woman of this decade, who also got her start before 2010, but really didn't take off as much until 2010. Would be our very own Stefanie Joanne Angelina Germanotta, otherwise known as Lady Gaga. Lady Gaga is not only a singer, songwriter, producer, she's an actress and a businesswoman as well. And she's more than Taylor Swift has been known for continuously reinventing herself throughout her career and for her versatility in numerous areas of the entertainment industry. If this rings a bell, reinventing yourself, it's a very Madonna thing to do. When we talked about Madonna a few weeks ago, we talked about how with each new album, she sort of created a new era for her characters, and Lady Gaga's done the same thing. So she started performing as a teenager and singing at open mic nights, and then she went to New York University, and that's where I went, and she wanted to pursue a music career. And she started working in the city, doing whatever she could do, any sort of open mic night, different things like that. And once she finally got a record label in 2007, she rose to fame with her debut album, The Fame. And this was in 2007. And a lot of these songs like Just Dance and Poker Face got really big. Then in 2009 and 2010, she took off even further when she reissued this album to have even more songs. And some of these songs are some of her most famous and popular. But, you know, she has done so much. She's had 5 studio albums. They've all debuted in the top 200. And she's explored so many different genres, electronic pop, electronic rock. And similar to Taylor, her 2011 album, Born This Way, sold more than 1 million copies in its first week. And its title track actually became the fastest selling song on the iTunes store with over 1 million downloads in less than a week. And she's just continued to change and transform. Her third album was a lot more electronic dance music influenced. And then she did a jazz album with Tony Bennett. And then she did a country pop and soft rock album called Joanne in 2016. And during this time is when she also ventured into acting. She played a role in the miniseries American Horror Story, and she got a Golden Globe for that. And then she also starred in the critically acclaimed musical drama A Star Is Born, which a lot of people really loved. And the big song Shallow came out of that, and they didn't know that she had that acting talent, because a lot of people hadn't watched her in American Horror Story, but she really proved herself to be worthy of that role in that position. She's won 11 Grammy Awards, and she's been declared Billboard's Artist and Woman of the Year among many different rankings on Forbes and other things like that. She's also just known for being an amazing person, for her philanthropy, her social activism, a lot of work about mental health and LGBTQ+ rights. And she's also founded her own nonprofit organization, the Born This Way Foundation, which focuses on empowering youth, improving mental health, and preventing bullying in all of its shapes and forms. And I think that she's just really, really admirable for that reason. And she's also close to home. She's a New York City girl who went to school at NYU, just like me. And it's really funny. It's just funny that this person came from so close by. She's, you know, gone through so many, and not only has she gone through eras in her music, but also in her performances, in her looks. She constantly changes her look and makes it fit for whatever era she's doing in her music. It's not just a music show. It's a full-blown theatrical production. And I think that's what people really, really appreciated about her when she would do numbers at the Grammys or the Oscars or whenever, you know, the Music Video Awards, whenever she would get a chance to do a number. She did not hold back in any way. And I really appreciate that about her, for always being as authentic to herself as she can and never holding back, always going 110% with everything that she would do. It's really, really awesome. And she just came out with a new album as well called Chromatica, which a lot of people were highly waiting in anticipation for a long time. And I really enjoyed it as well. I think there's a lot in there that incorporates some of her past works to a new future sound as well. So we'll listen to a little bit of one of her songs that debuted in 2010 that really took off. And this is one of the ones that, yeah, even though her first album would come out in 2007, 2009, 2010, when she issued some bonus tracks to that project, she got even more popular and rose to the fame at a higher level than she even thought was possible at that point. That romance, oh, caught in the bad romance. Yeah, so I really recommend listening to Lady Gaga as well. Like I said, she's just such an amazing person, and she's had so many different eras of music. So if you don't like one album, there's probably going to be another album that you like, because she's tried every single genre. She's jumped around so much, and she really makes it work in every single era, every single project. And she's from so close by. She's from New York. It's very interesting to think about it that way. So last but not least, certainly not least, we're going to have one singer who is an English singer who sold more than 120 million records. Anyone have any guesses? So this is Adele. We're going to be talking about Adele for our closing person. Adele is an English singer-songwriter, and she's from the UK. And she started her recording contract in 2006. And that was when she was 18 years old. When she started that. And she was planning on releasing her debut album, which was called 19, to focus on that era, that year of her life of turning 18 and 19. And it was supposed to be released in 2008, earlier 2008, but it was released at the end of 2008. It was delayed. And she got a lot of commercial and critical success. It was really well. It went really well. She appeared on Saturday Night Live, and that boosted her career in the United States. And she also performed at the 2009 Grammy Awards, and she won Best New Artist. But in 2011, when she released her real, you know, her album 19 was a real album, but it was her debut album, right? It was her introduction to the world. It was telling people who she was. And now that she'd garnered and gotten some fame already, some fans all from all over the world, her second studio album, 21, which came out in 2011, was a cultural reset in a lot of ways. It changed the pop music scene forever, in my opinion. It earned her numerous awards, record-tying 6 Grammy Awards, including Album of the Year and Brit Awards, British Album of the Year. It's the 4th best-selling album in the UK in all of history, which goes to show. And it, in the US, held the top position on the Billboard 200, longer than any album since 1985. And the best-selling album, it's the best-selling album worldwide of 2011 and 2012, selling over 31 million copies. And she was the first woman in the history of the Billboard Hot 100 to have 3 simultaneous top 10 singles as a lead artist, with her songs Rolling in the Deep, Someone Like You, and Set Fire to the Rain. So Adele's always worked in a pop and R&B soul genre, with a lot of singer-songwriter influence as well. A lot of people say that she is a soul artist too, but people say that because her voice has a lot of soul in it. It's a very raspy at some points and beautiful belting at other points, and that it has a lot of these elements from what people typically know as soul. But she is more of a pop singer-songwriter R&B artist, just with these influences from different people that we've talked about in the past, like Billie Holiday and Whitney Houston. They're all influences to somebody like Adele, who uses her voice softly and then strongly within the same songs. Her song Hello, which came out in 2015, was the first song in the US to sell over 1 million digital copies within a week. So she's won 13 Grammys. She's had a very successful career, but a little bit different from Taylor Swift and Lady Gaga. She kept herself out of the spotlight for most, and she still does. And they all do to a certain extent, but where Taylor Swift and Lady Gaga had a lot of other passions and things that they would work on outside, like documentaries and movies, Taylor Swift did her fair share of acting as well. Adele really hasn't done any of that. She's recorded music for some movies, but she's taken a lot of breaks in between all of her albums, especially from 21, the album 21, to the album 25 that came out in 2015. She had taken a 3-year break before she had started recording again. And I think that that's a great idea. I think that if the fame is getting to you, or if you are tired, then you need to take care of yourself first, because once you take care of yourself, then the chances of you creating powerful, amazing music go up. If you're not happy, if you're not healthy, then you're not going to be able to create what you know you can. So giving yourself time to regroup and revitalize is important, I think. So we don't really know when her next album is going to come out. Like I said, she is pretty on the low, and she doesn't make any of that clear. The one issue that was, you know, pretty upsetting for a lot of us fans was that she actually had been singing incorrectly her whole life. She had not been breathing correctly. She had not been breathing from her diaphragm, and a variety of other things, really just not knowing how to control her voice, although she did sound like she was in control. So she had to get throat surgery in 2011, 2012, and then made her comeback at the Grammys and was able to do it. But, you know, since then, I think she's always been a little bit hesitant to perform live, and just perform in general, because she has this condition now because of years of singing incorrectly. And, you know, hopefully it's okay, and hopefully that doesn't affect her too much, and hopefully she can keep performing and recording. but we're not really sure. But similarly to Taylor Swift, her lyrics are, and her stories are very, very, the lyrics in her songs are all stories, beautiful storytelling with a lot of showing and metaphors, and it's really describing heartbreak, relationships, things like that. And she didn't really like the comparisons between her and other female soul singers, calling that lazy, saying that just because we're all other, they're all women, doesn't mean that we're all the same, or that we all have the exact same influences, or that we sound the exact same. Not, we're not a genre. Women aren't a genre. And so she's always been pretty outspoken about the differences that, like, how women get treated differently in the music industry compared to men. And Taylor and Lady Gaga have also been very, very outspoken about that. And I think that everybody needs to be more outspoken about that because it is a very big problem. I went to music school in the city and I saw it firsthand. There's still a lot of work that needs to be done. But as her years went through, from the album 19 to the album 21 to the album 25, she kind of moved on from this soul and was sort of exploring folk and country and blues and pop in a way that was a little bit different from her original album, which was very one note in a lot of ways. Her album 25, she really talked about nostalgia, melancholy, the passage of time. It's really interesting to see the album 19, the album 21, and the album 25, because it's like they solidify these eras and these time periods in her life when she was actually these ages. And while Taylor and Lady Gaga, yeah, they reinvent themselves all the time, Adele really said, here is this age when I went through this, here is this age when I went through this, and here is this age when I went through this. And I think that's a really interesting way for when she's older and in the future to look back at her discography and think, wow, I had these records that were so influential at the time that in reality were just about like these timestamps in my life and these relationships that fell apart. And now I can really go back and pinpoint exactly when these different things happened through my own work, which I think is really, really cool. So to close out today, I'm just going to listen to a little bit of.
That you settled down, that you found a girl, that you're married now, that your dreams came true, that she gave you things couldn't give to
So that's gonna be all for today. Next week, we are going to talk about the history of musical theater. And that should be really exciting because I've also done a lot of musical theater in my time. But now we're at 2020 with our history of popular music. We've finally gotten here. I'm excited to see what the next decade entails. But as a takeaway from that, support more women artists. Support artists that you like, not artists that are available on the radio. Really look and find who you're interested in and support them. Smaller artists who are just starting, it's really important to support smaller artists as well. Because all of these super influential artists that we've talked about throughout the weeks, the Beatles, Bob Dylan, Elton John, Nirvana, Madonna, Lady Gaga, they didn't just start with a million fans. They were a small artist. They were all small artists at 1.2. And that's why it's really important to support local artists, just to support small artists so that they can grow to be these influential figures that have changed the music scene so much. Wonderful. So, yeah, you can tune in with me on Tuesday to start talking about the first half of the history of musical theater. Make sure to tune in on Monday to see Andrew talk about the violin and teach you some more things on the violin. Hope you guys all have a wonderful Friday, and I will see you on Tuesday. Bye, everyone.